Tentor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Intermittent Casting, a Widow's Bay novel by Rebecca Regnier, narrated by Traci Odom. Chapter 1. Elizabeth Bowden's Diary, 1692 Journey to Sault Ste. Marie. Brûlé was not used to having a child on his travels. This I learned quickly. I also learned how to ride quietly, but usefully in a canoe over dark waters, under black skies with sparkling stars. Canoe was the main method of passage from my home in Salem to the farthest point north and west I could have ever imagined. Farther than my parents could likely imagine either. Everything seemed so big to me, from the giant that was Etienne Brûlé to the vast forests and the tall trees. Even the rocks were bigger here. Squirrels were the size of cats. I was smaller, or felt so, than everything. At first, I missed them all, my mother and my siblings. I pined for the comfort of our hearth and the smell of the batter of a pop robin or boiled dumplings. Brûlé always had fresh meats on the open flame for me. I had more than enough. I was not hungry. But it wasn't sweet or familiar. I knew only Massachusetts in the first 8 years, and I knew only our town. To me, it seemed every person in Salem was a family member. Everyone at church was a parent or an elder that I must respect and mind. Along with the memories of apple butter and biscuits, there was another, darker memory. The memory of those in the church turning on one another. My mother and father tried to explain it to me when they packed my small sack and handed me over to Brûlé. Grandmother Nurse is to be hanged today. I don't remember the date. I do know it was hot. It was summer. It was the day Brûlé and I left Massachusetts, never to return. By nature, I am adaptable, and that was what I did then as now. I adapted to the new and strange adventure of traveling away from the only home I'd known. Brûlé was a larger man than my father and grandfather. He was two men combined into one, or so it seemed to me. He wore animal fur instead of woolens. His hair was tied with leather and grew long down his back in a thick tail. Had I seen him in a field by my home and did not know he was a man, I would think he was a bear or another snowy white beast. He was fearsome, but I only knew this when I watched others recoil or become nervous in his presence. I was not afraid of him, or he was never harsh or impatient. In some ways, he was more careful with me than my own grandmother Nurse. She could be fearsome, too. We moved from place to place from dusk until dawn each day. When I asked why, Brûlé said it was safer. I did ask a lot of questions. I think back now and wonder at how he did have patience with me. I like to chat with anyone, really. Brûlé introduced me to those who would ask as his daughter. I was to refer to him as mon père. He would tell trappers, merchants, and others who traveled that I was mon fille bien aimée. I did not know his language, but I did try to use the words and names he used. The farther we traveled, the fewer of these encounters occurred. Night after night passed. I saw dozens of sunsets and sunrises, but no other people. I did not have lessons then, from a book or in a church, but it seemed Brûlé was always teaching me something new. How did he know so many things, I wondered. I puzzled that his brain must be as big as his shoulders. At first, he caught the game for dinner, but soon I learned how as well. Brûlé instructed me how to prop a stone up with a stick and to add a bit of our salt pork or fish to lure the prey to the trap.
"Be mindful of your fingers, mon fille," he told me.
I was careful. I set up the traps right before sundown each evening and checked my work in the morning. Each morning there would be beaver or a lynx or raccoon. I learned the proper way to prepare each. I tried to sleep when he slept, but it was hard. The sun called me to its warmth, and my youthful energy knew no bounds. Brulé instructed me to stay within earshot of where he slept. In this, I was obedient. I was also a good pupil of how to respect the lands that we traveled and the animals that provided sustenance.
You will use all of the animal. You will also respect the spirit and sacrifice.
Brulé's voice was deep and sometimes hard to understand. He was French, and I did not understand his language or the way he used words. Many times he would have to point to things and show me because the words made no sense. The first time he told me to respect a spirit in an animal, I put my hands on my hips and looked at him as though he was standing on his head. I was not raised to think of spirits and beasts, and I worried, would my church elders be cross with me for it if they found out? But I did as he said and thanked the beaver, the otter, the rabbit, the groundhog. Slowly, I realized that the fur of the rabbit was a wonderful cap, and it kept the chill from my ears better than my woolen bonnet. The beaver pelt covered over the cowhide leather shoes my mother had put on my feet when she sent me away. And the raccoon was everywhere, which meant that I was never starving, even though there was scarcely ever bread to eat. After months of traveling on the rivers, the heat finally cooled, and the green trees turned orange, bright red, and vibrant yellow. The seasons had changed while we continued to move away from the salty air of my Massachusetts home. There was no salt in the air here, nor in the waters we traveled. I dipped my hand in the icy rivers whenever I was thirsty, and took a drink of water that was more pure, sweeter, and colder than I could ever remember back home. Home faded as an actual place. It became a story I told myself. My home now moved and changed with the night. Many hours were spent sliding over the rivers in the canoe. Other nights we would port or carry the canoe. It was too large for me, but Brulé fashioned a pack of supplies that fit on my shoulders. He would effortlessly hoist the boat over his head, and I would struggle with my little pack. We walked until we reached the next place in the river that would carry us. Brulé would steady the sides, and I would jump in. Brulé always knew the way, and I always knew to stay close and not to wander. I was raised to listen to my elders in all things at all times. I was a talkative child, and eventually, though Brulé was not similarly inclined, he tolerated me singing my songs and making up phrases for things that interested me along the way. He compared my childhood singing prattling away to the birdsong that also accompanied our days. I think he was amused by my voice, not angered, as sometimes my father and uncles were when I could not stay quiet. I could rarely stay quiet.
I shall never instruct you to be quiet or to stop asking your thousand questions. Unless there is a cougar or bear, then you shall be silent, but only then.
Brulé tweaked my nose with his big forefinger, and I laughed. My home faded into my memories, and it seemed some days that I'd always lived in the nighttime forests with Brulé. The night sky, the morning blue, the forest green pushed out the drab colors of the place I had left. We arrived, finally, to a settlement. Brulé pointed to it from a distance away. It was nearly dawn, and so, as was his routine, we would wait the day and embark again the next night. This had become usual to me. I studied the fort from our perch on the hill, a goodly distance away. The fort was built with impossibly long logs stacked on one another. They were piled high. Over the wall, which we could see thanks to our higher vantage point, there was a smattering of log buildings. I watched as smoke rose from the chimneys. After months of living in the open, I was eager to run in and sit by a hearth, and maybe play with children if there were any there. Maybe I would sleep on a bed above the ground. I was eager to rush in and explore. Since it was nearly sunrise, I could see people stirring. They were like my people in Salem. They would rise and start the day. Not start the day at dusk like I had these many months with my new caretaker.
This is Sault Ste. Marie.
Brûlé repeated the words, Sault Ste. Marie, and I echoed them as he said them. I fashioned it into a song. I liked the way the words felt on my tongue. He let me sing my song for a bit. Then abruptly, Brûlé put up a finger to his lips and said,
Soyez silencieux.
Be silent. I stopped my singing and stood still as a statue. Brûlé put out a hand and gathered me close. I stood behind his leg as he scanned the nearby forest. His body was taut, like a bow. His seriousness translated down to me, and I was afraid. What had happened? What was he looking for? Was it a cougar or a bear come to eat us like he'd warned? I saw motion in the trees. Maybe it was a wild animal. It was certainly bigger than the ones we'd trapped, though, not the size I imagined a bear to be, which was a bit disappointing.
Aha,
Brûlé said, and his body relaxed from the alert state he'd been in when he'd told me to be quiet.
Nindalis.
Brûlé. It wasn't a baby bear or a big cat. It was a girl. She ran toward Brûlé on the legs that reminded me of a doe. They were longer than mine by twice, and they were uncovered. I was fascinated, and I'm certain my eyes were as wide as they could be. Brûlé enfolded the girl with shiny black hair into a hug. I stepped back and continued to stay quiet. She was beautiful and was similar to some of the people from Indian tribes we'd encountered along this journey, but also different looking than anyone I'd ever seen. I'd been raised to fear Indians, but Brûlé had shown me a different way. He did not even use that word, Indian. He said there were many nations, so many that I was not able to keep up. Brûlé spoke their languages, and they almost treated him as one of them, or as their honored guest at times. The farther we moved away from Massachusetts, the more Brûlé's dress resembled the Algonquin and the other name, Ojibwe. But for his white hair, I would have thought he was from them, not from France. This strange and beautiful girl treated Brûlé as a father, and she a daughter. Or so it looked like to me from my youthful vantage point. It was the first inkling that I was not the first girl he had saved from a noose or a pyre.
Why are you so far out from the fort? Brûlé said to the girl.
This is the closest I have been for many months.
Why? I left you at the fort for shelter. You are too thin.
Brûlé was angry. I did not think I'd seen him angry in all our days of travel, but there was a glint to his blue eyes now, as the girl explained how she'd been in hiding. Her accent was not French, but it was also not like my home. Four men who are from your church, from your France, they held a sword and a patch of earth and told all of the nations these lands of the big waters and lakes were under the control of the king.
King Louis?
Yes, and they said we were welcome only if we became converted. Some of the Ojibwa have done so. I did not. Brûlé shook his head in disgust. I continued to be silent and tried to understand.
You will travel with us, then. We will continue on to the bay. I had hoped to provision here, but I will not with you all this one.
I think they mean to claim all of the lands.
I think you are right, and smarter than many.
Brûlé put a gentle hand on Nindana's hair. She smiled, and it reaffirmed what I had known in my heart. Brûlé was a father to her, and me, and maybe others. Not by blood, but in some other way. I did not know the words. Brûlé turned to me.
You do not have to continue to be silent.
We are not going to go to the town? I was somewhat disappointed. I did want to see it. I did want to have a roof over my head, at least for a night. You don't want to go there. It is no place for a girl. The beautiful girl with the shiny black hair put out her hand and took mine in it. She squeezed it. Her bones were fine, but her fingers were strong. And from that moment forward, I gained something infinitely more important than a roof over my head. I gained a sister. My name is Donis. What's yours? Elizabeth.
Chapter 2. Marzie.
Better than 50 Shades of Grey?
What?
Well, we're here, and you haven't looked up. It must be that good.
Shut up, Grady. Aunt Dorothy told me it was required reading. Where are we anyway?
I looked around.
I counted 6 little log homes arranged around a fire pit area. Things looked empty, but not deserted. The little structures were well maintained, but they looked like they'd been in these woods as long as the trees.
This is the hunting and fishing lodge for our pack. It's been here something like 200 years.
I marveled at that. It was still hard to get my head around how much history was hidden in the woods around Widow's Bay.
Any indoor plumbing?
No,
but also no internet or work emails.
That's a good point.
Your aunt doesn't even know where this place is.
I find that hard to believe.
Point for you. She knows just about everything.
I gently put down my book, The Witch That Got Away. Elizabeth was my many times great-grandmother. Aunt Dorothy had put me in this truck with Grady and put this book in my hands. I was now on what amounted to a witch mental health day. Did we get those? I didn't know. It was one of many things I didn't know, and it was piled on top of my current ever-growing list of worries. 1. How was my son Joe going to go on job interviews as a newly minted vampire? 2. Was Francis the ghost going to move on or hang around? 3. Would my coven wait for me as I worked through my crisis of confidence? 4. Did I have enough paid time off for this mental health day? 5. Was my boss, now that he knew he was a werewolf, able to control his urge to steal meat and continue to offer health benefits to his employees? 6. Would my son Sam remember to run the dishwasher while I was gone? 7. Did I put enough food out for Agnes and Bubba? 8. Was the balance in Widow's Bay secure, or were more bad Yooper Naturals invading? 9. Was Widow's Bay going to celebrate Midsummer with Ridge's plan or Pauline's? Would they fight about it? Could I stop it? 10. Did I pay the cable bill? Should I even have cable? I mean, I had Netflix. Grady shook me gently on the shoulder.
Hello? The point is to get away from your worries, not wallow in them.
Yeah, right. Grady had opened the back of his truck and was loading a cooler of food into the cabin. I stepped out and looked around. The Upper Peninsula had 2 seasons, as they said, winter and July. July was right around the corner. It was June, and the summer was shaping up to provide record hot temperatures. This was rare, and we were prepared to revel in it. The forest around Widow's Bay was spectacular. The plants and trees were lush, green, and... Ow! I slapped my neck as a bloodsucker of a different sort feasted on me. Welcome to the downside. Thirsty bugs.
Here.
Grady handed me some bug spray. I got to work coating every inch of exposed skin I could find. One of them got me really good already. They're brutal. He spoke the truth. Mosquitoes were real jerks up here this time of year. What's the plan? I mean, for our little weekend getaway.
Well, you're single. I'm single. You've essentially agreed to swipe right.
I'm not on a dating app. Are you? Grady raised his eyebrows at me in a way that let me know I did not want him to answer any further. I was throwing up my caution flag. I had 1 supernatural romantic entanglement. I didn't need 2.
Dating app. I mean, swiping. We've got a cabin to clean, lady. Those windows are gross.
Grady lifted a bottle of glass cleaner and swung a towel in the air. I laughed out loud.
He always had that effect of lightening my mood.
It was a valuable trait in a friend. Also, he'd saved me from all manner of evil. I mean, what was not to love? Technically, I was single. There was a point this year where I was firmly in the attached category when it came to my romantic life. I dated a 500-year-old vampire. We'd watched movies, flew on my broom together, and vanquished evil. You know, typical new relationship stuff. And then he turned my son into a bloodsucker to rival the one that just tried to make lunch out of my hemoglobin. It had put a real damper on the relationship. I understood the logic. My son was going to die. He'd sustained a mortal injury, and if my vampire ex-boyfriend didn't step in, I would have lost my son. It was unthinkable. But it had all happened while I was out cold. I didn't have a say in the epic shift in my child's life. My son had gone from college kid to immortal Yooper Natural without me signing a permission slip. I had not come to terms with it. But that really wasn't the worst of it. The worst of it was guilt. It was all my fault. That phrase played in my dreams, assaulted me when I let my mind idle and interrupted my appetite. It was all my fault. I blame myself. I'd used a spell to fix a personal problem. I abused my witch powers, and I was sure that the recent personal disaster was cosmic retribution. There was a terrible price for abusing our magic, and now my son was paying it. I had chosen to hide from the power I had. I did not know how to handle the job of being a witch, and so I was opting out. And I was cleaning a window. I pushed out thoughts of guilt with thoughts of how spotless this glass was going to be when I was done. I had been pleasantly surprised. The cabins here were very sweet, quiet, and certainly far from the pressures that had turned me upside down. I had my book, and I knew Aunt Dot just wanted me to have a little time away from Widow's Bay. Since I'd returned to my hometown, I hadn't had much downtime. Maybe that was what I needed to get my feet back under me. I just needed a breather. I had magical decision fatigue. After completing my window washing assignment, I took a step outside and took in the beauty of the spot. The trees were thick, tall, and provided a wall against the rest of the world. They were like the skyscrapers in New York City in that you couldn't really see the clouds from down here. Well, if I was going to take a day off, I ought to do more than clean house. I'm going to take a little walk. I looked around for Grady, but didn't see him. I supposed he was handling finding firewood or whatever other camping things needed to be done. The idea was to clear my head, so a walk on the path that cut through the trees seemed to be a good start on that plan. Though we were miles and miles from a town and the nearest road, still, it was not quiet here. The trills of cardinals and killdeers provided a constant song as I walked the dirt path. I hadn't walked far when the trees thinned. I emerged from the trees into a vista that took my breath away. It was stunning. It was as if a circle of pine trees had voluntarily taken a step back. It seemed there was an agreement in the forest that here we will let the grasses grow and the sunshine will reach the dirt. The pine green of the trees gave way to a riot of yellow, white, and pink. Bees and other insects bounced from bloom to bloom. This meadow of wildflowers stretched on for several acres at least. I was so glad it was here, so glad to see it, and so glad it was hidden. It deserved to be away from boots or camping stakes or Instagram selfies. I looked up at the sun. I'd missed it. It beat down on my face, and for the first time in a long time, I was warm. Well, for the first time, I didn't feel like it was a hormone-induced warm. Hot flashes made you feel like you'd swallowed a hot water bottle. They made you feel like your thermostat was broken. The warmth from the sun was a welcome change, a warmth from outside. It felt as though we might get a long, hot summer here in this northern place. I took in the sight and marveled again how few people knew the beauty of the Upper Peninsula. I thought about Elizabeth Bowden and wondered if she'd stared at this place once. It was easy to go back in time in my mind when there wasn't a cell phone tower or a billboard in sight. I had no doubt that this looked the same now as it had when Brulé and Elizabeth came here hundreds of years ago to keep her safe from the witch hunters of Salem. I took a few deep breaths and turned back. I was no slacker, and I figured Grady could use my help with whatever camp chore he had next on his list. The walk had done me good. For that alone, I'd have to thank Aunt Dorothy. When I returned to camp, Grady was working a hand pump for a well that I'd not seen when we arrived.
Here, best stuff on earth.
He'd filled a mason jar with water from the well. Safe to drink?
Heck yeah, and nice and cold.
I took a sip and realized he was right. I also realized we were lucky that the big businesses didn't know how good this water was. We'd be fighting them again to stop them from trying to set up shop in our pristine neck of the woods. The rest of the afternoon, we talked, walked, and Grady set up the fire pit. He got to the heart of my current crisis.
You're feeling guilty, Aunt Dorothy says.
My son is a vampire now, so yeah, guilt is one of the many awful emotions I'm feeling.
It's not like you turned him into one.
No, but you know the company I keep, the job I do. I put the kid in harm's way.
Kid? He's over 21, right?
Right.
And he wouldn't have seen 22 if it wasn't for the Frenchman. That's what I hear.
Grady and Brulé were not drinking buddies, to say the least. But they maintained a truce over the shared interest of keeping Pedro Alvarado, a real jerk of a vampire, at bay. And they worked together to keep the gate to Supernaturals open in Widow's Bay. The gate allowed the town to be a respite for all kinds of magical creatures, including me, the worst witch in the Midwest. I suppose. Grady didn't push the topic of my son any further, and we sat for a moment looking at the fire. As the sun went down, we sat in companionable silence. I didn't know if this was what Aunt Dorothy had in mind when she said I needed a walkabout, but I had to admit, I felt calmer and a little lighter since I'd slowed down and listened to the birds and helped tend Grady's fire pit. Maybe she was right. A few days would give me a better perspective. I looked over at Grady. The temperature had started to drop as the sun had set, but I realized Grady was sweating. Grady? He didn't answer me, and in fact, didn't seem to know I was even there. He also appeared to be struggling to keep his eyes open. I stood up and walked over to him. I put my hand on his shoulder. You okay? I felt the heat of his skin through his t-shirt.
Not great.
The hair on his forearm shifted and shimmered. It was a downy red one second, and a coarse animal fur of his werewolf incarnation the next moment. Are you planning to hunt?
What?
Your arm. He looked at it and saw what I saw.
No, for some reason my body wants to shift to werewolf.
Is it a full moon thing?
No, I have the power now to control it in all ways.
His skin seemed to settle back into human form. Then his body shook with the loudest sneeze I'd ever heard. Whoa, God bless you. He looked at me, and his eyes were rimmed red. Grady, are you allergic to something out here?
Why?
Your eyes are red. You're sneezing.
No idea. Maybe it was someone I ate.
What?
Kidding. A joke. I'm fine.
I'm calling Fawn.
I told you we don't have good cell service. You'd be better connecting with her here.
Grady pointed to his temple. I had a psychic ability, one that I hadn't fully figured out, but had admittedly saved my life more than once. But right now, psychic powers were firmly in the category of witch spellcasting in my book. I was on a cast fast. I can't be trusted with magic these days. I lifted my phone in the air to try to get bars. Nothing. Grady sneezed again, and it was very weird to see him as anything but strong and vigorous. He was decidedly not that at the moment. I need to get service. You just stay here and figure out whom you want to eat for dinner. I mean, what you want to eat for dinner. Grady didn't catch my joke, and I worried anew. He was sick, and whatever afflicted him came on strong and fast. I walked over to the truck and, in a mood that was as awkward as possible, managed to climb up on the roof of it to elevate my phone. After contorting my arm and phone to achieve a bar of service, my phone started vibrating nonstop. A million messages had found their way in on the sliver of satellite service I grabbed from the ether. "Call immediately." That was from Garrett DeWitt, my boss at Your UP News. I was about to do it, and then it vibrated again. "Vacation canceled. Call ASAP." I tried to get service so I could help Grady. Instead, it appeared work was melting down. I dialed Garrett DeWitt's number.
"Marzie, finally, sorry, but you're going to have to head back. We have breaking news and we can't be soft on it."
"What?" Weston Redman.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.